Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We have the most prompt bell ringers on all of the Fusky. Right at the stroke of 10, they start ringing. And of course, we know what that means. It is time to gather together to worship the Lord. I am glad that you are all here. And as always, I'd like to open us up for our worship service today, reading a few verses from God's Word. Psalm 34, verses 1 through 3 say these things to us this morning. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Amen. This is God's word as we begin our time of worship together. Let's lift up our hearts in prayer, shall we? Gracious Father, Lord, what a gift it is to be able to gather this morning as your body of believers in this special place to worship you, to exalt you, Father. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be working in our hearts and in our minds, focusing us, concentrating us on the throne upon which you and you alone sit. May we indeed glorify you in a worthy manner this day, Father. May there come nothing else between us and you as we seek to rejoice in all that you have done for us. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. All right. Well, where are we going to start out with our morning praise to him?
We're going to sing the song of redemption, Love Lifted Me, number 505. Please stand when you have it. 505.
Please go ahead, take your seats for a moment if you would. Glad you could be here joining us on the last Sunday of October. I know it's one of those crazy things as the months just speed past to think that we are now closing in on Thanksgiving. I know some of you are waiting for me to not skip over Halloween, and I apologize if I went past that just a little too fast, but you may have noticed here it is our fifth Sunday in the month. Bill Alston is indeed not here. He and I chatted. He wasn't quite up to coming down this week, so what he's going to do is target the 20th of November. That makes the best day on the island even better, because we have a wonderful worship service with Bill Alston leading into community Thanksgiving. So, if you were planning on not being on the island that Sunday, cancel all your plans. You want to be here. You don't want to miss that. It's a great, great day on the island. A couple other things to remind you of. Working in reverse order, November 26th, that Saturday after Thanksgiving, is the holiday market. Going to be held down at the Merrifield School. Tanya is in the back, and a few others as well that can answer all of your questions about what that's going to look like and what it takes to be involved in it. So put that on your calendars. On the 13th, which is in 2 weeks, after our service, we will have our annual meeting for our members. So if you wish to stick around and see the business of the church, feel free to put that on your calendar, and we'll take care of that. Next Sunday, Daylight Savings Sunday. Spring forward, fall back. So, turn your clocks back an hour, enjoy an extra hour of sleep, and then come on. Love to have you join us then, well rested. So, are there other announcements for the congregation? Kathy?
Don't forget to vote. And for those of you who don't know, our precinct here on Defusky is located at Jane Hamilton School near the museum. Very easy to find. Also, we plan to do flags again on our veterans' graves for Veterans Day, which is Friday the 11th. And so, yes, 11th.
Yes.
If you would like to be involved, we put flags on the graves of our 21 veterans buried here on Defusky. If you would like to be involved, we'll probably do it either Thursday or Friday. Let me know if you have a preference as to which day. We put a little caravan together and start here at the church and say a prayer and then go around and put flags on all the graves. We do that twice a year, and this one is our Veterans Day recognition. We have two heroes, actually five heroes buried here on Defusky, and if you'd like to know more about them, please come along, and it'll be very interesting. We see five cemeteries.
Wonderful. And clearly the person to talk to more about that is not me, but it's Kathy. A couple of other just simple housekeeping announcements. Our coffee ministry, again, thank you for being in full swing right back there on the table. Feel free to help yourself with that. Restrooms are in the little outbuilding here behind the church. And if you have one of these in your pocket, if you would please do everybody the kindness of at least turning it to silent. You can turn it off if you dare. I talked with somebody today that said that they even dared leave their phone at home this morning. I'm going to have to use the old-fashioned Bible, the one with printed pages and words. So, okay. In that case, having gotten us off to a good start, from where you're seated right now, look around, turn around and swivel your head. Identify somebody that you don't know. Because what I want you to do now in our time of fellowship is get up and go meet them. Get to know their name. If you happen to pass somebody that you know along the way, at least greet them too. But see if you can get to know somebody else who is here worshiping with you this morning. That's your task at hand. Off to fellowship.
Thank you.
All right, you fellowshipping people, how'd you do? Anybody meet somebody new? Burke, who'd you meet?
I met Casey and Julie Long, who are here from Nashville. They just moved to the island in July, and their daughter Lindley, who's just a wonderful, wonderful little girl, and there we...
Overachiever.
He studied biology in second grade.
Okay, fantastic, thank you. See, it's as simple as that. All right, I hope that we all feel a little bit closer together as a family in Christ here on our special little island. But our vocal cords are definitely warmed up, even better, Kathy.
Okay.
What are we gonna sing this time?
Another hymn of redemption, number 191, There is Power in the Blood. Please, stand when you have it. There's power in the blood, 191. Go ahead, take your seats again. We have come to that time in our worship service for prayer requests, praise reports, and testimonies. That interactive portion of our service where if you don't feel like listening to me and my message, you would now have to go on and on about how we can be in prayer for one another. And that'd be okay. I'm all right with that. I'm not going to shorten my message anyway. But how can we be in prayer for each other? What's going on in your lives? How can we put our arms around each other and walk together in love? Blair?
Well, I have a prayer request. Is that what you were asking?
Yes. Blair, this is it.
I'd like to do a prayer request for my aunt, Aunt Bobby. Her health is in decline, and she's starting some new treatments, and so hope and pray that they are successful.
All right. Lane started us off. Who next? Ann.
Bill and Barb Farah both had COVID. Mm-hmm. I need say no more. Not feeling poorly, I think, is the word.
Okay. Prayers. Kathy.
Carol Baum and Gary Baum, our beloved Dr. Carol, as many of you know, went up to Ohio or Michigan, wherever, to visit their grandson, Max, for his third birthday, and they both came down with COVID. Fully vaxxed, boosted, the whole nine yards, and they have mild cases, but they missed the birthday party. Mm.
So prayers for Carol and Gary as they come home safe.
Okay. Others? Yes. Do it.
Mine are in Casey's parents. My in-laws will be flying in from Oklahoma on Saturday, so please pray for their safe travels and as we pick them up and a joyful trip here. On a personal note, two things. My mother is really struggling with our move. She really is sad that she doesn't get to see us to the frequency used to. So if we could just pray for her to have the peace and the understanding that this is where God has put us and that this is a lovely place for us. And then lastly, I have some major things happening at work and some major changes. So I'm going to ask that the church pray for the guidance of my corporation and the new leadership, that things will get better. On a side note, no more Sundays will I have to work at least. But I'll have to have my phone, but not have to be there or be on the phone. So that's a praise report. So all three things.
Wonderful. Thank you. Others? Yes, Jeff.
I've got praise. Miss Carolyn's been home for a week.
That's why it's a clean shirt.
Not only is it clean, it's new.
I've got a prayer request. Justin Dye's grandfather has COVID-like symptoms. You know Justin. Justin's in Boise with his grandfather who helped raise him. He's a dear friend of mine. And, I called him yesterday three or four times. He finally answered. He said, I'm in the hospital.
Andrea?
This is going to be a little longer. So on Tuesday is All Saints Day, and I would like to commemorate All Saints Day. My grandmother brought me to church, and that all is possible because over 500 years ago, Martin Luther put 99 theses on a church door. In Germany. So I would like to praise him for being a saint to the overall church, making us all able to go to church and understand what's being said. And lastly, I would like to hold in prayer Lucine Barboyan, who died this past week, and she's the wife of a co-worker of Andre, and Andre will fly to the funeral tomorrow, and well, actually tonight. But so I would like to come over to her.
Others, yes.
Sorry to double dip.
That's allowed. See, you saw others. We've gone three deep so far, so you got at least two to go.
Well, on a somber note, a prayer for Lee Creese's family. He was an integral part of this island, and he's passed away. So a prayer for everybody involved in his family.
Thank you. Others? Yes, sure.
Nancy also called me from Philadelphia and was hoping for prayers for her brother who's entering hospice this week. So he's got brain and lung cancer. He's in his 40s. So she's there taking care of him and the mother. And she said, if you see that pastor fellow, I said, well, I'm pretty sure I'll see him. So, yeah.
Nancy's been coming to our Sunday evening services. Mm-hmm. Okay. Others? I don't want to miss anybody. Okay. Well, for those of you that have been here a while, you know the drill. For those of you who haven't been here, here comes your homework assignment. We're going to pray together corporately as we do. I'll lead us. I will try not to botch names, and if I do, forgive me. Be praying along with an attentive spirit so that when the Holy Spirit decides to just touch your heart, with one of these prayer requests, please take ownership of it and make it yours. Write it down. Put it in your phone. You still have it, and if it's on, whatever it takes. Just make note of that prayer request, and when you have your quiet time with the Lord this week, lift up that prayer request as well. See that person's face when you're saying a prayer. Just remember them. And if you see them later on in the week, ask them how they're doing. Check in on them. That's how we love each other. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Most merciful God, Lord, we cannot begin to understand the depths of your love for us. But you have invited us to bring all that weighs heavily on our hearts to you. And so as your church, Father, we come to you this morning. Lord, we want to lift up Bobby and just pray that you would hold her tenderly. Would you watch out for her health, Father, if possible, if you would heal her and restore her. But in all ways, comfort her, Lord. And let her rest in your arms. Be with the family of Lee Creef in his passing. Would you be a source of comfort and strength for them as they mourn his loss? Would you be with those friends of ours who are dealing with COVID for Bill and Barbara, if you would please, Lord, help them get healthy again, restore them. For Carol and Gary as well, Lord, if you would help them to recover so that they can make their way back. Father, for Justin Dye's grandfather, it sounds bad right now, Lord, but we know that you can restore if you see fit. We pray that your healing touch would be upon him. Lord, we want to lift up to you Julie and her requests for in-laws coming to visit. We pray that their travel would be smooth, that their visit would be enjoyable and fruitful and edifying. We also want to lift up Julie's mom, Lord, as she struggles with their move far away from her. Would you just comfort her, Lord, and help fill the loneliness? And we just pray also for the major changes that are undergoing at her work. Would you provide wisdom and leadership to them? May they make good decisions and may the transitions be smooth for all, especially Julie and her family. Father, we give you thanks for having brought Carolyn back to us from such a long distance and time away. We are grateful for her return to worship with us. Lord, for All Saints Day coming up, I want to lift up to you Andrea's grandfather in praise as the one responsible for bringing her into your church, exposing her to your word, the salvation of your son, Jesus Christ. We give him praise and we thank you for his life. We thank you for Martin Luther, for the transformative efforts that he undertook, guided by your spirit, making your church more accessible, more understandable to a world that desperately needs it. And for Andre's co-worker's wife, who just passed away, we just pray, Father, that you would be with family, that you would be a source of comfort and strength for them as well. And Lord, we want to lift up to you Nancy and her brother as he is in his last days in hospice. Would you comfort him, Lord? Would you prepare his heart for receiving you, your son Jesus, for his shed blood, so that he might walk from this world into the next with joy and gladness? And give Nancy the strength and the peace to persevere in this precious and tender ministry of tending to her brother as well. Lord, there are other prayer requests that are in the hearts and minds of your people that are gathered here today. But we know that your Holy Spirit has already sought them out from the very depths of our souls and brought them before you. So we trust that you have them, Lord, all laid out before you, and that you will do whatever is best and right for us. For you are God and we are your people. So do with us as you will, Lord. We thank you and love you, Father. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. All right, well, as we continue along in our worship service, it's time for our scripture reading. I'm going to have Anne read for us out of the 51st Psalm.
Psalm Psalm 51, verses 4 through 12. Against you, you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. The word of the Lord.
All right, well, as we continue on in our worship service, we've reached that time in our service for the offering. And Jeff, can I call upon you and Casey? Gentlemen, if you don't mind wielding the plates this morning, a reminder that God does indeed love a cheerful giver. I always interpret that to mean that if you are not about to give with joy and gladness in your heart, then perhaps you should not be giving this morning. Because you need to come to grips with the fact that everything that you have and all that you are is a gift from God Himself. And if we haven't gotten you a place where you get joy out of that, well, like I said, there's work to be done. But we as a church are grateful for whatever you give. And as always, I do want to remind you that the greatest gifts that you have to give to God simply will not fit in these plates. So as Brian blesses us with a gift from the keyboard, be mindful that you have similar gifts to bless his kingdom. Use them wisely. And as we do prepare for this message, I would ask you all to bow your heads one more time and pray with me. Gracious Father, Lord, would you please empty me of myself right now, Lord. Get me out of the way so that your word can be proclaimed through me. Lord, would your Holy Spirit also be working in our minds so that we would hear these words and receive them and understand them as you would have them be meant to be heard. And Lord, would your Spirit also be working in our hearts, setting our hearts on fire with a love for the things that you love most, Lord. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, as we start, I do want to invite you to find Psalm 51 in your Bibles. It's page 457 if you're following along in the Blue Pew Bibles. But while you're looking for that, I want to tell you a story. It was springtime, the time of the year when the kings go to war. You may be saying to yourself, I didn't realize there was a time of the year when the kings went to war. But 3,000 years ago, when you were in an agrarian society and you didn't have a standing army, you needed people to work the farms. You needed food to eat. And so you didn't go to war when your farmers were either harvesting what they'd already grown or getting ready to grow more. So that gave you a window of time in the spring, in the springtime, when kings go to war. King David sent Joab and his armies out to do battle. But he stayed behind. He was probably 40, 45 years old. Still that age in a man's life where he thinks he can keep up with the young whippersnappers. So I'm not really sure why he didn't go out to battle with his men, with his army. But he didn't. One evening, he found himself strolling about on the rooftop of his palace. And as he gazed out over the city of Jerusalem, he saw that he was not the only person out on their roofs that evening. He gazed and saw a woman, or as he could tell, a beautiful woman, taking a bath on a roof. Now, we've all seen things we shouldn't see. A prudent person, upon realizing that that's something they shouldn't see, turns away. Doesn't seem that that's what David did. Because David said, huh, who's that? Well, somebody went and found out. And they came back and said, her name's Bathsheba. Her husband is Uriah the Hittite. Now, that name would have immediately registered with David, because Uriah is identified elsewhere in Scripture as one of David's mighty men, one of his valiant soldiers, whose bravery, whose skill, his strength, and his loyalty was sufficient to be called out by name, remembered throughout the millennium as one who did battle for David in a mighty way. That woman that you gaze upon, that's Uriah's wife. Kings back then are much like kings today. You don't tell kings what to do. And that day, King David said, go get her. And so messengers went. They went to Uriah's home, called Bathsheba, and said, come with us, young lady. The Bible doesn't tell us how the next events transpired. It doesn't tell us what was said. It simply tells us that ultimately she went from there to David's bed. I can promise you this. She had no ability to say no, because you don't say no to the king. For those of you keeping score at home, that's adultery with the likelihood of rape. Thank you, King David, a man after God's own heart. David sends Bathsheba home, thinks he's done with his sin, until he gets word from Bathsheba. King, you got a prince on the way. What are you going to do? When you're a man after God's own heart, you don't think of yourself as a sinner. David didn't want to be thought of as a sinner, and so he started spinning the wheels. What can I do so that the world won't think that I just went ahead and took the wife of one of my best soldiers? He concocts a plan. Sends a note to Joab saying, hey, I need an update from the battlefront. Would you please send Uriah to me? Uriah's wife is pregnant, his best way out is to make Uriah think that he's the dad. So he calls Uriah, says, come, give me a report. And so Uriah comes back from the front, comes to the castle, and gives David an update. David says, okay, great, relax, enjoy, have some food, take some comfort. Now go home, why don't you go to your wife. You got a beautiful wife at home, just go and enjoy your house. You can go back to the front tomorrow. Alas, he didn't understand that these soldiers are loyal to the king and to each other. And these other soldiers, Uriah's brothers in arms, were out sleeping in the field in the open air. Uriah could not stand the thought of being at home enjoying the comforts of his wife while his fellow soldiers were in such a state. And so he puts down a mat and he sleeps in the castle floor. David is thinking, this is not going the way I want. Uriah, maybe you shouldn't go back to the front today. I know that you're missing your brothers in arms, but listen, why don't you stay here for the evening one more time? We'll fatten you up, we'll get you good food, get you some drink, and then you can go off tomorrow. David was thinking, I just didn't get him drunk enough. So tonight, I'll get him so that he doesn't understand what he's doing, and he'll go back to his wife. That didn't work either. And so here is David confronted with this mighty man who at this moment is so much bigger than King David. So David says, all right, Uriah, wait right here. King David then says, plan A didn't work. Time to go to plan B. And he writes a note to Joab, his general, commander of his armies. And in that note, he says, when Uriah gets back, I want you to send him up to where the fighting is the fiercest. And in the heat of the battle, I want you to have all the other men retreat and leave Uriah exposed to the wrath of the enemy. Seals the letter, hands it to Uriah to deliver to Joab, and sends him on his way. He makes the man carry his own order of execution. Joab receives this letter and has no idea what Uriah has done to so offend the king, but he assumes there's got to be a good reason, because David's a good king, a man after God's own heart, and he goes along with it. He follows the orders of the king, and Uriah is killed. Adultery, likely rape, premeditated murder. Capital offenses that would have cost the life of anybody in that time. The king thinks he's gotten away with the cover-up, covering up his sin. Bathsheba has her period of mourning. The king says, come on in, you're now going to be part of my family. And she moves in. All is good for the man after God's own heart, who's just committed capital offenses and seemingly gotten away with it. And then Nathan, not a man after God's own heart, a man who was God's mouthpiece, obedient to God, is sent to do the thing that no one ever wants to do. No one ever wants to call the king on the carpet. But if you are obedient to God, if you are faithful to God, and God says, go and do this, you go. And so Nathan goes, and he tells David a tale. I want to read this to you because I think it's so brilliant how he did it. Nathan says to David, who has no idea why he's there, there were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb that he had bought. He had raised it, and he grew it up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare the meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man, and he prepared it for the one who had come to him. Listen to David's response. David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this must die. He must pay for the lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity." I don't know if you've experienced this in your own life, in times of your own sin, where you've gotten so wrapped up in the cover-up that you've lost sight of what you actually did. You start thinking, I've gotten far enough out of people's sight that no matter what it is that you did, it has faded into the background, that you can be so oblivious to the horrendous nature of your behavior. That's where David was. This guy's got to die for what he did. Until Nathan then says, "You are this man." Quick point on that. We are in an era where it seems like the greatest sin one can ever commit is to judge somebody else for the sins that they've committed. Don't you dare call out somebody else, because we're all a bunch of sinners. But the reality is, Nathan was sent by God to confront a man with his own sin. David responded like a man after God's own heart. How you respond when you are confronted with sin in your life will show an awful lot about where your heart is too. Upon realizing that he had done something that had not been hidden from God, that was offensive to God and offensive to him, David repents. He truly, deeply repents. And all of this is my buildup for Psalm 51, because Psalm 51 was written by David in response to these events. You can look at the beginning of Psalm 51, that introductory component where it says that this is all done when the prophet Nathan came to him after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba. What does repentance look like, my friends? I want to propose to you that what flows out of Psalm 51 is a three-pronged message. One that says that when there is true repentance, it will lead to restoration, which will be evidenced by reformation. Building on 95 Theses. Repentance leading to restoration, demonstrated by reformation. And so if you look at the opening verses, where David is crying out with pen and paper, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me." What we see in these words, that great recognition that David is steeped in sin. He has gone far aflung God's plan for him. And he is in deep trouble. And he has but one option: to throw himself at the feet of God, acknowledge his sin, and pray for mercy. This is what repentance looks like. "I have totally screwed up. I followed my way and not your way. And I'm sorry. And I'm turning from it. And I'm turning to you." Martin Luther said this. He said, "There are two elements in true repentance. There is recognition of sin and recognition of grace. Or, to use more familiar terms, there is the fear of God and trust in mercy." David is showing those points right here. God, I fear you, and I am at your mercy, because I have done that which should never have been done. If you carry on, though, and look at verse 4, this is where things get really interesting to me theologically. Because he says this, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. It's very difficult to read those verses and not want to cry out, I'm not sure Uriah feels the same way. But here's the reality. Sin is when we do something contrary to God's will or God's law. That will always have an implication in the world. But it is against God that we sin, but our trespasses are experienced by others. We break God's law, and the natural result is to hurt somebody else, to hurt ourselves. That's what sin does. But at its very core, sin destroys the relationship with the one who is holy and right and just. And that's what David acknowledges here. The most important thing is for me to have a right relationship with you, God. And I'm far from it. I have screwed up. And you were right, and you were just. And whatever your verdict is, shall be right and just as well, for you can do no other. And then he cries out, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. This is one of those places where we get from the Bible this notion of original sin. David crying out that even in my womb I was sinful. I was born to be a sinner. My body will always sin. Until it goes back into the ground, there will be sin in it. That doesn't say anything about you being unjust because you were perfect. It just means that I'm not. And we need to deal with that if I am to be right with you. And so David then says, cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Hyssop was used, you may recall, to apply the blood of the Passover lamb over the door frame of the Jewish families as they were preparing to flee from Egypt, as God was about to take the firstborn of those who were not covered by the blood of the lamb. The priests also used hyssop to apply the holy purifying water as well. David's saying, I can't clean myself, God. Only you can do that. Wash me. Purify me. Clean me from my sin. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Repentance leading to restoration. Some of these words seem strange to us in the New Testament era, because when Jesus ascended back to heaven, he told his disciples, I'm going to send my Holy Spirit to abide in you, an advocate who will help you to keep my commands. And so, as New Testament followers of Christ, we have this promise of the Holy Spirit living in us, abiding in us, never to leave us, never to forsake us. We who have been baptized with the Holy Spirit should never experience what David is experiencing in this moment right now. The absence of the Holy Spirit in his life. That's not how things worked in the Old Testament days. The Holy Spirit would come down for a time, for a moment, for a season, to dwell within, to empower. It may have been with a leader like Joshua. It may have been with a great warrior like Samson. It may have been within a prophet like Ezekiel. But the Holy Spirit would come on down and empower for a moment. Jesus promised he will come and live with you forever. But I want you to understand David, as one through whom the Holy Spirit had spoken, he knew what fellowship with the Holy Spirit was like. We talked about this last week. When you walk so closely with God that you feel his presence and you know his voice, for him to be absent from your life is painful. It cuts to the very core of who you are, because you realize who you are is his. To have that broken is to be broken yourself. And so David cries out, "I am repenting of my ways. Restore me into the joy of your salvation. Come near to me again, God. It can only happen if you will cleanse me out of your mercy and out of your abiding love." True repentance leading to restoration, as demonstrated by reformation. What's that reformation look like? David says this: "Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of my bloodshed, O God, you who are God my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. God, restore me, and I'll let the whole world know. There won't be a person that comes into me that doesn't understand that you are the true King, not me. For you do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart you, God, will not despise." Understand what restoration and subsequent reformation looks like. God put in place this order of sacrificial offerings. But what he really wanted was our heart in obedience to him. What he really wanted was us inclined to justice and mercy, loving kindness for our neighbors. That's what he really wanted for us. Our sacrifices and offerings were for when we screwed up. What he really wanted was our hearts. A broken spirit, a contrite heart, is what he wants from us. He wanted it then, he wants it today. That's what reformation looks like. God demanded a sacrifice. That sacrifice is us and our will. Not my will, but thy will be done, Lord. That is what reformation looks like in the life of one who has repented, who has been restored in their salvation, who has been reformed in their life. Psalm 51 ends with some curious verses. They seem a little bit out of place, but there's an important thing to understand. Because King David, important to remember who was writing this, then says, "May it please you to prosper Zion, to build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in the sacrifices of the righteous and burnt offerings offered whole. Then bulls will be offered on your altar." I mentioned earlier that sin is never contained solely within the sinner. The implications are far-reaching. If you are the father in a home and you sin, all the household feels it. When you are the king and you sin, all the kingdom suffers. We don't think that way. In fact, I would think that this is an important part in our ultimate repentance and restoration that is manifested in our reformation. When we realize that the sin that we committed carried forth and impacted the lives of so many others, at the very least, we say, "God, bless them who I have hurt. Look upon them as if they have never sinned, because I'm the one that caused that pain. I don't know if anybody in this room has committed adultery. I don't know if anybody in this room has committed murder. I'll tell you this, though, if you read Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, he pretty much convicts all of us of that anyway. We are all in need of repentance. We are all in need of restoration. And we all need to demonstrate that through our reformation. Not because our salvation is works-based, but because the joy of our salvation transforms our lives and causes us to do that which is pleasing to God. We are that pleasing sacrifice in God's eyes. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And for that, we were issued the due penalty of death. But God had mercy on us. He cleansed us with hyssop, washed us whiter than snow, through the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. Your salvation has been restored, friends.